Kita semua memiliki prioritas yang berbeda. Prioritasku dalam berkarya adalah mewujudkan sebuah visi. Aku ingin semua yang telah kucapai tidak berhenti di sini, namun terus berkembang. Tidak ada yang memahami prioritasku selain diriku sendiri dan Bank Mandiri.
Mandiri Prioritas, memahami prioritas Anda untuk kini dan masa depan.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shalom, Om Swastiastu, Namo Buddhaya, Salam Kebajikan. Selamat sore dan salam sehat untuk kita semua. Selamat datang Bapak Ibu sekalian dalam acara Mandiri Private Webinar Financing the Sustainable Economy yang diselenggarakan oleh Forbes Indonesia, Lombard Odier, dan juga Mandiri Private. Perkenalkan, saya Zilvia Iskandar sebagai host untuk acara hari ini. Bapak Ibu sekalian, hampir 250 tahun yang lalu, Glasgow adalah tempat di mana inovasi James Watt yang berupa mesin uap menandai lahirnya era revolusi industri pertama. Kemajuan-kemajuan yang dihasilkan dengan meningkatnya pertumbuhan ekonomi tentu tidak terlepas dari konsumsi bahan bakar fosil yang menyebabkan peralihan fungsi lahan dalam skala luas untuk kebutuhan industri. Hal tersebut berkontribusi signifikan terhadap krisis perubahan iklim yang kita hadapi saat ini. Dengan kondisi bumi yang semakin berbahaya, para pemimpin dunia kembali bertemu pada awal bulan ini di kota yang sama untuk acara COP26. Meskipun kebutuhan untuk bertindak atas perubahan iklim telah disepakati secara umum selama beberapa waktu, komitmen nyata baru dibuat untuk pertama kalinya di Paris pada COP21 tahun 2015 lalu. Namun sejak saat itu, progres untuk mencapai tujuan tersebut melambat. Oleh karena itu, kita berharap komitmen yang sudah diperbarui pada COP26 dapat menjadi katalis untuk aksi-aksi nyata ke depannya. Bapak Ibu sekalian, pada tahun 2015, para anggota PBB juga telah menandatangani agenda pembangunan berkelanjutan 2030 SDGs. Ada 17 tujuan pembangunan berkelanjutan yang menjadi rujukan pemerintah dan juga perusahaan untuk berkolaborasi dalam menentukan arah pembangunan negara di masa yang akan datang. Pada tahun 2017, Komisi Bisnis dan Pembangunan Berkelanjutan menyimpulkan bahwa berpartisipasi dalam tujuan pembangunan berkelanjutan juga membawa dampak yang baik bagi bisnis. Dengan mencapai tujuan global untuk 4 sistem ekonomi saja, dapat membuka 60 market hotspots senilai kurang lebih $12 triliun pada tahun 2030. Nah, apalagi jika ke-17 goals tersebut tercapai, maka tentu keuntungan ekonomi yang bisa masuk ke kas negara bisa mencapai 2 hingga 3 kali lipat lebih tinggi dari angka tersebut. Bapak Ibu sekalian, dengan dorongan dari para konsumen yang saat ini lebih kritis, lebih vokal, kini pemerintah dan perusahaan mau berinvestasi pada proses dan teknologi yang baru yang memang diperlukan untuk mewujudkan ekonomi yang berkelanjutan. Tidak heran, saat ini para investor akan mengukur dampak sebuah investasi itu pada SDGs sebelum akhirnya sepakat untuk mendanai proyek-proyek baru. Sejalan dengan pergeseran paradigma pengambilan keputusan investasi, maka hari ini Forbes Indonesia, Mandiri Private, dan juga Lombard Odier mengambil tema webinar Financing the Sustainable Economy. Hari ini kita akan berdiskusi dengan 3 pembicara yang tentu saja ahli di bidangnya masing-masing. Kemudian setelah itu, kita akan lihat apakah ada waktu untuk sesi Q&A. Barulah setelah itu kita akan menampilkan nanti juga ada undian ya, door prize di akhir acara. Baiklah Bapak-Ibu sekalian, setelah itu kita langsung saja masuk ke acara inti kita pada hari ini. Saya akan langsung memperkenalkan 3 pembicara pada acara Mandiri Private Webinar hari ini. Saya akan memperkenalkan dan menyapa 3 pembicara kita. Yang pertama adalah Dr. Thomas Hone Sparboth, Head of Sustainable Research at Lombard Odier. Hello, Dr. Thomas. How are you?
Very well, thank you. Good to
Very
be
well.
With you.
I hope you are doing well. Okay. So, Dr. Thomas Hone Sparboth is a master's graduate in strategic studies and international economics. Dr. Thomas completed his doctorate at the London School of Economics. His dissertation was entitled Socioeconomic Spillover Effects of Armed Conflict on Neighboring Countries and included fieldwork in Zambia and Southern Africa. He previously spent 7.5 years in economics and analytics at Roskilde before joining Lombard Odier in 2019. Dr. Thomas is a planetary economist focusing on the transitions to a net zero, nature positive, circular and inclusive economies. He is also a specialist in the assessment of sustainability and alignment with planetary boundaries across companies, industries and supply chains and its integration in investment decisions, policy and consumer choices. He is also a regular keynote speaker on sustainability, disruptive technologies, global megatrends and climate change. So, that is Dr. Thomas, and our next speaker, pembicara kita yang kedua adalah Bapak Michael Gizar, Executive Vice President of Moderna Global Ltd. So, Bapak Michael Gizar, having studied consumer psychology from Stanford University, Michael balances his role in Moderna, a global electronics brand which is making the transition from home appliances to creating an energy ecosystem brand with his passions on developing new technologies, battery and changing the consumer landscape. In addition to founding Mologies, a B2B digital logistic marketplace powered by blockchain smart contracts, he also serves on Indonesia's National Olympic Committee and is a member of the Strategic Millennials Advisors to the Speaker of Indonesia House of Representatives. So, Pak Michael, how are you, Pak Michael?
I'm doing well. Thank you very much. Okay.
Pak Michael, so are you ready for our session for today?
Yes, I am.
Okay. Before that, Pak Michael, I'm going to introduce our next speaker, which is Bapak Andri Asmoro, Chief Economist Bank Mandiri. Pak Andri, apa kabar, Pak Andri? Baik ya, Pak. Oke. Bapak Andri Asmoro adalah lulusan S2 Georgia State University di bidang ekonomi. Bapak Andri juga telah berkarir sebagai ekonom di bidang perbankan dan investasi selama 21 tahun. Sebelumnya, beliau bekerja sebagai Senior Research Assistant di lembaga Think Tank Ekonomi Universitas Indonesia sebelum bekerja sebagai ekonom di Bahana Securities dan juga Bank CIMB Niaga. Bapak Andri kemudian bergabung dengan Bank Mandiri pada tahun 2011 dan diangkat sebagai Chief Economist pada tahun 2019. Baiklah, Bapak Ibu sekalian, ketiga pembicara kita sudah bergabung. Kita akan langsung memulai sesi talk show kita pada hari ini. Saya akan mulai bertanya kepada Bapak Andri terlebih dahulu ya. Pak Andri, jadi sebelum kita masuk ke pertanyaan seputar webinar kita pada hari ini, tentu kita ingin mengetahui bagaimana sebetulnya kondisi perekonomian kita saat ini, terutama ketika kita sudah hampir 2 tahun menghadapi pandemi COVID-19, Pak, dan bagaimana outlook ekonomi untuk tahun berikutnya, tahun 2022.
Oke, baik. Terima kasih pertanyaannya, Mbak Zilvia. Saya punya materi presentasi. Berapa lama waktu presentasinya?
Nanti kami akan sampaikan, Pak. Sekarang, Bapak, kita akan putarkan dulu presentasinya, ya.
Oke, baik. Jadi, Mbak Zilvia dan teman-teman, Bapak-Ibu di Mandiri Private Webinar, jadi kalau kita lihat apa tantangan perekonomian Indonesia, next slide, maybe. Saya akan mulai dengan bagaimana gambaran kita Indonesia economic, the challenges and opportunities ahead. Ya, of course, when we talk about the challenges and opportunities, yang pertama adalah kita bicara tentang bagaimana tantangan ekonomi Indonesia dalam menghadapi pandemi. Ya, sebenarnya kalau kita lihat dalam posisi yang awal ini, ya di bulan ini situasinya sedang mendukung. Ya, COVID cases-nya itu lagi rendah. Namun kita juga sekarang sedang bersiap siaga untuk menghindari masuknya varian baru misalnya ya ke Indonesia, dan kita berharap tidak ada lonjakan lagi seperti yang kita alami di bulan Juli. Nah, tentu saja yang kedua kalau kita bicara dari sisi VUCA ya, itu adalah tentang digital disruption, but I rather to say it in a digital opportunities actually ya. Bagaimana kita memanfaatkan peluang-peluang dari akselerasi ekonomi digital. Dan yang ketiga adalah, nah ini tantangannya nih nanti, when we move out from fuel-based economy to more clean-based or green economy, tentu saja transisinya harus smooth, ya. Smooth transition is needed. Karena kalau misalnya tidak smooth, tentu saja akan terjadi energy crisis, seperti yang kita alami dalam beberapa bulan terakhir ini, di mana harga komoditas kemudian melejit dan memberikan tekanan kepada sektor industri manufaktur. Yang kedua, tentu saja ketika kita bicara tentang kondisi ekonomi saat ini adalah kondisi di mana adanya imbalances in growth, ya, global growth between the advanced economies yang punya vaccination rate-nya sudah sangat pesat dibandingkan dengan developing economies. Ya, tentu saja kalau kita bicara dengan antara negara maju dengan developing economies, kita bicara bagaimana kondisi saat ini di Afrika misalnya. Ya, tentu saja ini akan berdampak kepada pemulihan ekonomi yang tidak merata. Nah, tantangan berikutnya ketika ekonomi tidak merata adalah respons kebijakan juga tidak sama gitu. Kita saat ini pasca pandemi adalah bersiap menghadapi respons kebijakan di negara maju di mana ekonominya sudah tinggi ya pertumbuhannya, kemudian inflasi juga sudah relatif tinggi, kemudian mereka sudah mulai bersiap-siap untuk pindah kebijakan dari yang relatif lebih more supportive dan push liquidity kepada yang lebih tightening untuk menahan tingkat inflasi yang tinggi. Nah, ini tentu saja akan berdampak kepada ekonomi negara berkembang termasuk Indonesia. Yang ketiga adalah tentu saja when we talk about the future ya from 2021 to 2022, of course there is a big shift people economics behavior ya post pandemic. Our data for example, sorry, my slide please. So our data in Mandiri Spending Index really tells about the changes on behavior. Ya, dan tentu saja dunia usaha harus mengadopsi adanya perubahan dari people's behavior ini. Kemudian yang penting adalah how to improve people's capacity. Nah, kalau kita bicara yang disampaikan oleh Pak Wis dalam arahan utama di dalam bahwa ada satu poin penting di situ, yaitu wujudkan SDM unggul. Nah, tentu saja ini adalah cara untuk mendukung adanya di teknologi dan juga poin yang keempat, adanya isu mengenai climate change dan juga ESG. Next slide, please. Nah, ini yang kita hadapi tantangan after pandemic. Jadi, saya coba buat blok dari 2020 towards 2025. When we talk about the policy, for example, ya dari 2020, 2020, 2022, terus juga ada blok 2023, 2024. Blok 2020, 20 ke 22 tentu saja kita bicara tentang how to survive from the pandemic. When the pandemic shifted to become a pandemic, of course we have to accelerate our growth dan situasinya juga memungkinkan karena memang polisinya itu juga mendukung. Jadi polisinya mendukung dengan iklim interest rate juga yang masih relatif masih rendah. Nah, tahun depan ini udah kita bersiap nih, ada kemungkinan suku bunga acuan global juga akan relatif meningkat. Inflasi relatif meningkat. Jadi post the pandemic, the developing economies including Indonesia have to face another round of the challenges. Nah, itu dia yang perlu kita riding ke depan ya. Tentu saja kita berharap bahwa setelah vaksinasinya sukses ya paling tidak sudah relatif lebih besar lagi proporsi orang yang divaksinasi, tentu saja kita berharap pertumbuhan ekonomi Indonesia 2022 itu akan relatif lebih baik dibandingkan dengan 2021. Next slide, please. Nah, kita lihat di sini bagaimana gambaran ekonomi global ke depan. Yang menarik adalah ada tiga poin di sini. Yang pertama, when we discuss about 2021 economic growth, of course, the economy ya will grow fast, much faster compared to 2020 because of the first one is because of the low base effect. Ya. Jadi karena low base effect, tentu saja pertumbuhan ekonomi ya di Amerika Serikat, di global itu akan sangat tinggi. Yang kedua adalah memang karena adanya tingkat vaksinasi yang juga belum merata yang tadi saya sampaikan, ada pertumbuhan ekonomi di negara-negara maju yang memang lebih cepat. Jadi negara seperti Amerika Serikat tumbuh lebih tinggi dan kemudian 2022 akan melandai. Tapi ada negara yang memang late recover seperti Indonesia misalnya, relatif rendah ya dibandingkan dengan negara lain misalnya yang sudah lebih cepat vaksinasinya, namun di tahun 2022 akan relatif lebih tinggi. Nah, poin yang ketiga adalah what we face post the pandemic is that the global economic growth itu well moderated or flattened. Ya, jadi kalau kita lihat average global growth di tahun 2023 sampai dengan 2026 itu rata-ratanya sebenarnya kalau proyeksinya IMF ya, itu menariknya adalah tidak relatif lebih tinggi dibandingkan dengan pre-pandemi. Nah, ini challenge juga how do we find a new source of growth ya for global growth including our economy. Next slide please. Nah, ini adalah kalau tadi kita bicara tentang pertumbuhan ekonomi, ini adalah bagaimana direction dari interest rate. Jadi, Bapak Ibu semua, kalau kita bicara tentang how to optimize the lower environment, the lower interest rate environment, itu adalah sebenarnya 2020, 2021, dan mungkin di mid sampai dengan mid tahun 2022, ya, di mana interest rate memang masih sangat rendah. Nah, kemudian ke depan kalau kita bicara atau jadikan misalnya interest rate dari Amerika Serikat, the Fed fund rate, itu apa arahnya ke depan, itu diperkirakan di long run-nya itu akan menjadi 2,5%. Tahun 2022 ekspektasinya itu kemudian akan naik sekali, jadi ke 0,5%. So we will have to face ya another round of the challenges like I mentioned before. Jadi dari 2021 ke 2022 adalah interest rate yang relatif meningkat. Next slide. Nah, menariknya adalah pertanyaan banyak orang adalah bagaimana dengan kondisi ekonomi Indonesia saat ini dibandingkan dengan situasi ketika Amerika Serikat mulai mengetatkan kebijakan moneternya, yaitu waktu itu 2013 yang kita bisa jadikan acuan. 2013 terjadi taper tantrum ketika stimulus kemudian mulai perlahan dikurangi. Ya, stimulus moneter misalnya. Nah, kondisi ekonomi Indonesia saat ini relatif jauh lebih baik. Saya ada tunjukkan 6 indicators ini. Dari current account balance, fiscal deficit, debt to GDP, forex reserve, inflation, dan juga current volatility. Jadi kalau kita bicara dengan yang pertama saja, current account deficit. Tentu saja Bapak-Ibu semua masih ingat di tahun 2013 Indonesia was categorized as the fragile five because of higher deficit in the current account. Right now, Indonesia's current account deficit only reached around minus 0.4% compared to what we had in 2013, minus 3.2%. The fiscal, walaupun naik, kalau kita lihat, ya ini semua negara naik, tapi relatively well managed, including the debt to GDP ratio. Our debt to GDP ratio itu only reached around 41%. It is reaching or much higher compared to what we had in 2013. But compared to other emerging market, for example, Indonesia's debt to GDP ratio is relatively well maintained and much lower compared to, for example, what we had in Vietnam, Thailand, ya, yeah, for example, Philippines, Malaysia. Malaysia itu mencapai 67%, bahkan India 90% daripada GDP. Nah, kemudian kalau kita lihat FX reserve, cadangan devisa kita untuk menahan volatility, ini buat Bapak-Ibu semua yang misalnya mengkhawatirkan apakah ada currency risk ke depannya. Kalau kita lihat sekarang, ya cadangan devisa Indonesia 2013 itu mencapai 93 billion US dollar. Indonesia right now CADEV-nya itu mencapai 145 billion US dollar. So we do the simulation. Right now Indonesia for example ya foreign ownership in government bonds only reaching around 21% of the total. Ya, sementara tahun 2013 itu 31%, sekarang 21% turun around 10%. Nah, kalau misalnya saja ya foreign ownership ya because of rising interest rate going forward in the US for example drop to 14% in Indonesia itu equal to 20 to 30 billion US dollar going out from Indonesia's bond market for example. Bank Indonesia could still intervene the currency ya. Kenapa dari 145 billion dikurangi 20 or 30 billion even? Ya, masih di atas 100 billion US dollar. Ya, masih equal to more than 7 months of import and debt repayment. Nah, jadi relatif masih bisa manageable dan saya masih percaya bahwa currency risk akan relatif minimal compare what we had in 2013 during the taper tantrum period. Next slide. Nah, ini dia yang tadi saya sampaikan. Walaupun memang ada pressure dari capital outflows akhir-akhir ini, kemarin misalnya ada sentimen ya rupiah relatif ada melemah ya karena munculnya varian baru Omicron misalnya di South Africa dan negara-negara lain di Afrika. Tapi kalau kita bandingkan misalnya volatility-nya atau pelemahannya Indonesia ya rupiah dibanding US dollar yang chart di kanan kiri itu relatif lebih kecil dibandingkan negara-negara berkembang lain. Kita bicara Turki, kita bicara Thailand, Korea, Brazil, Malaysia, Indonesia's currency is relatively well managed yeah, and less volatile compared to other currencies. So we believe that going forward, in the midst of tapering, yeah, dan juga expected rising interest rate, Indonesia's currency should be well managed as well. Next slide. Nah, ini sekarang kita masuk ke bagian pertumbuhan ekonomi Indonesia. Sebelum kita masuk ke bagaimana sih kondisi realnya spending masyarakat dan juga sektor-sektor apa yang kemudian relatifly sekarang sudah tumbuh. Kita berharap memang ekonomi di fourth quarter itu akan mencapai 5%. Jadi memang kenapa alasannya 5%? Karena kalau kita lihat dari leading indicators kita, Mandiri Spending Index, itu memang sudah terlihat bahwa recovery dari spending itu mulai terus berlanjut. Ya, post di bulan Juli yang lalu, ya drop di bulan Juli, kemudian di August, September, dan Oktober, until now, in November, for example, ya itu spending index terus meningkat. Nah, dari sisi itu sebenarnya memang relatif ada peluang ya pertumbuhan di kuartal 4 akan relatif lebih baik, sehingga kita berharap pertumbuhan di tahun 2021 ini akan mencapai 3,7%. Kemudian berlanjut ke 5,17% 2022, tentu saja dengan harapan sektor real juga akan ikut jalan, ya akan ikut growth. Ya. Next slide. Nah, dorongan yang lainnya adalah dari belanja pemerintah. Ya. Di tengah strategi pemerintah dalam melakukan konsolidasi fiskal, kalau kita lihat di sini, Bapak-Ibu, bahwa pemerintah tetap menganggarkan belanja negara yang cukup tinggi ya, walaupun pertumbuhannya 0,4%, tapi the good thing coming from the fiscal side was that the government didn't cut the spending, and rather they will allocate towards a more effective spending. Jadi kalau kita lihat di sini ada 6 sebenarnya arah atau fokus kebijakan dari sisi spending yang dicanangkan oleh Pak Presiden dan juga Bu Sri Mulyani. Ya, misalnya ada yang terkait dengan bagaimana kita mempersiapkan juga tetap kalau misalnya ada kasus baru atau ada kenaikan kasus, pemerintah tetap siaga dari sisi kesehatan dan juga perlinsos. Yang kedua adalah kita tidak mau berada dalam kondisi di tengah pandemi terus. Ya, kita berharap ada juga pertumbuhan ekonomi Indonesia yang tetap sustainable. Jadi ini keseimbangan bagaimana kita pulih dari pandemi dan juga mendorong pertumbuhan yang lebih sustainable. Nah, dari sini kita melihat bahwa pemerintah juga menganggarkan untuk membangun SDM, membangun infrastruktur, yang melanjutkan infrastruktur, dan juga bagaimana coordinating with the pemerintah daerah. Next slide, please. Nah, ini yang kita lihat di sini, Bapak-Ibu semua. Jadi kalau ditanyakan bagaimana kemudian target pemerintah, nah, di sini terlihat bahwa pemerintah benar-benar memikirkan how to balancing ya antara infrastructure, health dan juga education. Next slide. Nah, ini juga kalau kita lihat ya dari Mandiri Spending Index kita ya, ini terlihat nih Bapak Ibu semua setelah drop di bulan Juli yang lalu kemudian recover ya sejak bulan Agustus. Ya, meningkat terus ya, bahkan sampai dengan nih datanya di bulan November. Data Mandiri Spending Index ini menjadi leading karena biasanya inline nih dengan bagaimana gambaran Consumer Confidence Index ke depan dan juga bagaimana gambaran dari retail sales index ke depan. Jadi kalau kita bicara tentang spending index kita, ini memang terlihat bahwa kondisi saat ini relatif jauh lebih baik dibandingkan dengan kondisi di bulan Januari 2020 yang lalu. Next slide, please. Nah, kalau dilihat dari lebih dalam lagi di antar pulau, kita melihat bahwa satu-satunya pulau yang memang masih lagging, dan kita memang mengerti karena memang pulau tersebut sangat tergantung oleh pulihnya industri pariwisata, yaitu Bali Nusa Tenggara yang biru di bawah. Itu kita lihat di sini, bahwa pulau-pulau yang lain pun juga sudah recover, sudah di atas angka 100%. Ya, sementara kalau kita lihat untuk yang Bali Nusa Tenggara, walaupun masih di bawah, there was a gradual recovery, ya, from the 45.7 points, kemudian sekarang sudah reaching 51.4%. Jadi kalau kita lihat di sini, setelah ada pelonggaran mobility, there was a relaxation in mobility, then it affects to the tourism sectors in Bali and Nusa Tenggara. We hope that kalau nggak ada ini, if there were mobility restrictions, strict mobility restriction, for example, we believe that the mobility to Bali will improve quite significant. Next slide. Nah, ini kalau kita lihat, banyak yang bertanya kepada saya, ya, orang Indonesia tuh kalau belanja untuk apa saja? What the Indonesian people spend much, ya, compared to other countries, for example. Nah, dari data kita, ini memang terlihat ada top 5 dari spendingnya masyarakat. Yang pertama dari sisi restorannya, yang kemudian household, fashion, supermarket. Jadi restoran ini lebih menggambarkan bagaimana spending di untuk di food and beverages. Jadi 20.8% coming to restaurants, dan kemudian kalau kita lihat 11.7% to household, itu belanja rumah tangga, dan yang menarik adalah belanja to fashion, spending to fashion, jadi all kind of fashion. Kalau kita mengambil ini to represent the non-food and beverages spending, or spending to non-food and beverages, non-food and beverages. Nah, kalau kita lihat di sini, arahnya semakin lama semakin meningkat. Jadi, there was a rule of thumb when Indonesian people start to spend more on non-food and beverages, it means that the Indonesian people starting to believe or becoming more confident on the economic condition. Nah, ini adalah suatu indikator yang positif. Jadi, kalau kita lihat di bulan Juli saja, misalnya, itu proporsinya hanya 4.7%. Sekarang udah 10.9%. Jadi kalau kita lihat lagi di bulan April tahun 2020 yang di kolom kelima ini misalnya, kolom keempat maksud saya, itu drop to 4.3% during the PSBB, the first PSBB ever ya in Indonesia ya during the pandemic. Next slide. Nah, tadi disebut tentang how we optimize ya the momentum to be more sustainable, to do the more on the green economy and also boosting the renewable energy. Jadi kalau dilihat di sini Indonesia is very attractive. Kenapa? Karena memang kalau kita lihat Indonesia juga punya hutan yang besar ya, kemudian juga punya sumber daya juga yang bisa kita manfaatkan untuk lebih dimanfaatkan untuk green economy ya. Nah, government sendiri very committed ya to aiming to reach energy mix ya by 23% to 2025. Jadi kalau kita lihat di sini EBT or renewable energy, energi baru terbarukan, itu improving targetnya dari 11.2% to 23%. Jadi increasing to 23% dari all the electricity sources ya, energy sources itu naik ke 23%. Jadi memang kita berharap bahwa electricity sources ke depan itu akan di-fuel by renewable energy. Next slide. Nah, ini adalah gambaran terakhir kami ya, bagaimana indicators ekonomi Indonesia sebagai bagian dari target ke depan 2022 untuk GDP ya, already mention it ya bahwa Indonesia's economy could grow by 5.17% going forward, but the risk going forward of course when we talk about the rising inflation rate ya, kalau ekonomi Indonesia membaik tentu saja tantangan berikutnya adalah how to manage the inflation ya, how to manage the low inflation. Jadi kita memang melihat ada kenaikan namun memang masih dalam rentang Bank Indonesia. Kita memang memperkirakan kemudian yang ketiga, BI 7 days reverse repo rate or Indonesia's interest rate itu akan naik ya benchmark rate-nya dari 3.5% tahun ini. Jadi kemungkinan nih BI tidak akan menaikkan sampai dengan tahun ini. Kemungkinan juga kalau baseline kita itu sampai dengan semester 1 masih akan flat di kisaran 3.5% sebelum kemudian naik ke 4% di akhir tahun 2022. USD IDR itu akan relatively weaker ya, but we don't see any significant weaker ya compared to the current level. Jadi kalau kita lihat di sini end of period-nya USD IDR-nya to 14,000 around 14,400 ya. Nah, kemudian bond yield-nya memang akan relatif naik dari 6.3% prognosis dan juga ekspektasi kami to 6.7%. Other than that, saya rasa itu gambaran saya. Terima kasih. Kalau ada pertanyaan, nanti kita bisa lanjutkan kembali. Terima kasih, Mbak Zilvia.
Terima kasih Pak Andri atas penjelasannya yang sangat komprehensif mengenai kondisi ekonomi dan juga prospek ekonomi tidak hanya di Indonesia ya, tapi secara global seperti apa. Terima kasih Pak Andri atas penjelasannya.
Thank you.
Berikutnya hadirin sekalian, sebelum kita masuk ke sesi tanya jawab dengan Dr. Thomas, kita akan simak terlebih dahulu video berikut ini.
It's time we face the irrefutable truth. The irrefutable truth is net zero is not up for debate. The irrefutable truth is the CO2 tap is being turned off fast. The irrefutable truth is every company must adapt to a post-carbon world. Clean energy and electric vehicles alone won't save us. It's a carbon-free existence or no existence. It's net zero everything or nothing. It's transition or extinction. It's now or never. But there is hope. There is progress. There is transition. There are industries and companies we cannot live without already on the true path to net zero. With a holistic, scientific perspective, our net zero investing strategies identify and invest in them to build diversified and decarbonized portfolios resilient enough to benefit from the economy-wide shocks of a net zero transition today, tomorrow, and for generations to come. This is the irrefutable truth. It's a truth worth investing in. Rethink net zero. Rethink investment. Rethink everything.
Okay, so very interesting video. Dr. Thomas, perhaps to help the audience understand the big picture about on climate change goals, could you please share some of the headline figures on the growth of greenhouse on gas emissions, the actions required to reach net zero, and how this has evolved since the COP21?
Of course, thank you very much. And perhaps if I could use some of my slides to help illustrate that. First, thank you very much for having me here to talk about this topic, which is certainly front of our agenda today, because we believe this issue is very material to the investment community, from a perspective of risk, also from a perspective of return. If we look at where emissions are today, they're at close to 60 billion tons per year being emitted into the atmosphere. And that amount has doubled over the last 50 years. Now, that's quite a long time frame over which emissions have doubled. And now, as part of the Paris Agreement, as part of the realization that the world needs to move towards a lower carbon economy, to keep global warming levels below 1.5 degrees, if possible, we need to start cutting those emissions at a much faster rate. We need to reduce them by about half in about 10 years' time. So the same amount that we've taken 50 years to expand our economy into, we now need to take out over a much shorter period of time. So that's a fundamental economic transformation that is both has both the scale of the Industrial Revolution, but will unfold at a much faster pace. If we could put up some of my slides, please, then I can maybe make some of these points as to where we are today after COP26. If we could go to my first slide, where we were at the Paris Agreement and where much of the real economy is, the next slide, please. Where much of the real economy still is today, we're still on track to around 2.5 to 3 degrees of global warming, if you just look at where current policies would take us. Now, the Paris Agreement is ultimately seeking to limit warming to around 1.5 degrees only. So we're still quite far removed from that goal. Fortunately, over the last month at COP26, where we were also there to understand what was being discussed, we have seen a significant move in some of the targets and some of the pledges that have come out from different governments. If we take all of those at face value, those would succeed in bringing emissions down quickly enough to keep warming at least to around 1.8 degrees. And for the first time, it is within the range of the Paris Agreement, which sought to recognize that as an upper limit we should really try to work to keep warming below 2 degrees, if at all possible, to stave off the worst effects of physical risks and changes to our climate. Now, although that in itself might seem as some cause for hope, if we actually look at what the near-term targets of governments are implying, they're much less ambitious. They would still be only sufficient to keep warming to 2.4 degrees, significantly above the objective of the Paris Agreement, leading to significantly more physical consequences. And what this is an indication of is that many governments are saying we will take action, but most of this action will only start taking after 2030. And that, of course, is not quite good enough. Now, if we go to the next slide, if we look at everything that's come out of COP26, when the UK, which held the presidency this year, went into this, they really had four dual objectives. They called it coal, cash, cars, and trees. On coal, some 40 countries have pledged to move towards an accelerated phase out or phase down of coal in the 2030s for some of the wealthier nations, 2040s for other ones. That, of course, will be a significant boost to investment in renewables. At the same time, this has been called the finance COP, if you will, meaning that for the first, the finance industry was at the table in full force, recognizing the financial relevance of these issues. On cars and other key technologies, a number of countries have now recognized that we need to significantly invest in a number of key technologies that can help debottleneck the transition, ranging from vehicles and steel to more sustainable, regenerative forms of agriculture. And finally, the big theme that has come out of COP was on trees, ceasing deforestation. We recognize that ending deforestation is one of the lowest cost interventions we can make to indeed reduce the amount of emissions we put into the atmosphere. If we could go to my final slide just on this point. The next slide, please. Thank you. What we'd also like to emphasize is that this isn't just about government pledges. Ultimately, the role of governments is to lay out a roadmap where regulation might take us, where incentives might be evolving into, but then it moves over to a next business cycle. Investors recognizing, indeed, where some governments are looking to take us, increasing investment in key technologies, in turn increasing the availability of green products, decreasing their cost, improving the economies of scale, and that in turn will change the economics of green technologies and the transition to such an extent that in the next cycle of negotiations, which will now happen even in 2022, we hope to see a further ramp up in government ambition taking place to bring us ever closer to that 1.5 degree goal. So we're moving in the right direction. We're not yet where we need to be. We do believe that at least we're missed. Thank you.
Okay, so Dr. Thomas, you have explained to us a very interesting material about rethink net zero. My next question is, being the ultimate capitalist market, you know that the investment sector has been one of the leading groups to recognize that the need to drive change through the allocation of capital. So could you please share how much funding is actually available right now and some of the key criteria for its deployment going forward?
Yes, absolutely. So there have been some big numbers that have come out of COP26. One of these surrounds what's called the Glasgow Financial Alliance for Net Zero. It's an alliance headed by Mark Carney, old governor of the UK Central Bank. And it now comprises a number of alliances of asset managers, of asset owners, who together have some $130 trillion in assets owned or assets managed. Now, what that capital represents, it's not a flow of capital, new investments, it's a pool, a stock of capital, where the owners and managers of these assets now realize that indeed this issue is part of their fiduciary duty to understand. Because the scale of the transition is so significant and so profound that if we do not take this into consideration, as part of our financial due diligence, then indeed we may very well be exposed to mounting transitional, physical, and liability risks. So for this 130 trillion, these owners and managers are now essentially committed to understanding what kind of risks and what kind of opportunities this transition to a lower carbon economy presents, and how we can start to realign portfolios towards that. That is one big part of the objective, to decarbonize our economy, to decarbonize our portfolios. The other side of the coin is to ramp up investment in green technologies, in the decarbonization of our economy itself, in some of the technologies that will be needed, in some of the demand side changes that will be required. The International Energy Agency, for instance, has estimated that by 2030, we will need new investments of around $5 trillion per year to be invested in renewable energy, but also very much in buildings, industry, and transport to try and wean some of these sectors off their reliance on fossil fuels. So that presents an enormous investment opportunity for which capital now needs to start being mobilized. The big challenge there perhaps is not so much the availability of capital, but actually understanding where that capital should be deployed, in which regions regulation is already aligned to these technological roadmaps, and which asset classes those opportunities will materialize, and what the risk profile associated with some of these investments will look like. So the opportunity for investors certainly is very significant.
And in this new investment environment, how actually are the projects and also management teams are being evaluated?
Sure. If maybe here we could go to one of my slides, specifically the slide on page 11. Today, many investors, I think, are still looking when they try to assess the climate alignment of any investment by looking at the carbon footprint of that investment. They take into consideration whether an asset or an investment is high emitting or not. We don't believe that's necessarily the right approach. What we have seen emerge in the market is a move from investors away from high emitting industries and sectors and companies towards lower emitting ones. So that might mean that an investor might seek to pull their money out of sectors such as steel, cement, or chemicals just because they're high emitting and put it into healthcare and education or tech because they're lower emitting. However, what we realize is that all of these higher emitting sectors, such as steel, cement, and chemicals, will remain economically essential even in the future. The challenge, therefore, becomes not so much divesting these sectors, but rather identifying within these sectors these companies that are actually aligned to rapid decarbonization, that have credible strategies in place, credible governance structures, that understand the commercial implications of this. So we need to try and identify companies and managers that are able to identify which assets are indeed rapidly decarbonizing, because that is ultimately where the biggest reductions can be achieved. It is also where companies may develop the most significant green competitive advantages. So it's all about transition for us.
Okay. Thank you so much for your explanation, Dr. Thomas. And next we are heading to Pak Michael. Pak Michael, I'm going to ask you in Bahasa, but please feel free to answer it in English or in Bahasa, it's up to you. So, jika ketersediaan pembiayaan adalah push factor, Pak, kemudian ekspektasi konsumen adalah pull factor untuk membuat perusahaan itu fokus pada kebutuhan transisi perubahan iklim, boleh dong, Pak, di-share apa contoh perubahan yang pernah Anda lakukan di perusahaan di mana momentum perubahan saat itu ditentukan oleh perilaku dan aktivitas konsumen, ya?
Thank you, Sylvia. Let me start by clearing up. For the record, I think consumer activism is a necessary practice in the system. This is important as an agent of change. Activism correlates to brand loyalty and therefore growth and revenue as well. Younger generations in particular are using their brand choices, spending, and personal energy to advance their beliefs. I've read in an international report stating that consumers ages from 18 to 24 years old are three times more likely to change and switch brands based on values than those who are above 65 years old. So nowadays, you can understand that the young millennials are becoming more and more significant as part of the workforce and as part of the consumer targets that brands are targeting, just like us at Modena. They want to be a part of something big. So even nowadays, as you know, not only when we're talking about the products when we're targeting to the customer, but also to people who are also joining Modena, we're also trying to find people when they're looking for their first, for them to become part of something that is big and meaningful as well. Although in the past, a lot of consumer activism has been focused in areas of unethical race practices, unfair pace, nowadays, consumer-based companies are focusing their interests on reaching zero carbon footprint, which is something that we're really focused on at the moment. For Modena in particular, for many years, Modena is known as a home appliances brand. But nowadays, we're focused on innovating new products like solar ACs. Our power pad, just for the record, is our home battery solutions, which is tackling two problems. We're tackling the issue of energy stability in emerging countries, including Indonesia, and remote areas as well, which Indonesia is not accustomed to as well. And secondly, we're also a brand that's developing products which is allowing independent from the grid. So you don't need to have electricity from the government as your only source of electricity anymore.
Okay.
Consumerism is... Yeah, sorry.
Oh, Michael.
Yes, you were saying?
It's okay for you to continue if you still have one to explain.
Sure, I just wanted to close in on the fact that consumerism is really important for brands to change. So, but at the same time, I think we have to try to solve a bigger problem. So for many years, we're dedicated on developing an entire divisional arm, it's called Modena Energy, to provide clean, renewable energy solutions as a new category of home appliances outside of your traditional offerings such as washing machine, refrigerators, and such.
Okay, thank you for your explanation. And also, Pak Michael, perhaps you could share a little on the history of Modena and its business today. And also, how has the technology evolution led Modena to refocus the way it invests into its current business lines? And what is the key focus as your transition towards home automation?
Sure, absolutely. So my late grandfather, Thomas Jezar, was an early futurist. So before Modena was founded, my late grandfather, Thomas Jezar, founded an ice cream company. It was one of the first ice cream companies in the region, in Southeast Asia. It was called Flipper. But then he sold this to a European FMCG company. And then this opened the door to Europe for Thomas Jezar to then explore and founded Modena, other Italian gentlemen, in the Emilia-Romagna region of Italy, in a city called Modena, hence why the name is Modena. We were one of the first manufacturers for the cooking appliance. That's why until today, people still correlate Modena with its cooking appliance. But people, although we're still selling products, and manufacturing them in Italy and Europe, it is solely owned by our family today. So today, when you're talking about our business and how we're trying to dive into different businesses as well, we've taken the skill set of research and development and on creating home appliance products from sketch to scale. And we're also trying to then, using these skills, expand our to bring in the latest in the home automation, which is called Modena Seamless. What the Modena Seamless is all about is all about connecting the home, connecting the city, and connecting mobility in a singular platform. So nowadays, one of the biggest assets and one of the biggest category that we're focusing is on commercializing battery storage systems. So we call this the power pad and the power tube. And we're also working on trying to bring renewable energy at an affordable price. So we're developing this line of products, so including the solar ACs, the power pad. I'll speak about what we're working on in other regions of the world. So in the Middle East and Europe, where there's less sensitive to price, we're bringing products that are very high quality, and we're trying to push items that are you know, for people to have this power pad in their homes. So every home will be installed by a power pad and also by our solar pad, which is our solar solutions as well. In countries where they have a little bit more price sensitive consumers, like Pakistan, for example, which is quite similar to Indonesia, perhaps 15 to 20 years ago, we're trying to sell our solar AC. And one of the reasons for that is that a lot of the major cities like Karachi, Lahore, and Islamabad, they're facing blackouts once every 2 weeks. And this is a rate that's going on, and this is happening quite often. So one of the ways that we're trying to push these solutions in countries like Pakistan and there Indonesia and in countries in Southeast Asia is that we need to have financing solutions. Mm. So we need to try to educate the market, selling at the same time, but having financing solutions. So the way that we are financing it is saying that, look, instead of you have to pay to the government for your own electricity and then, you know, having a instability for electricity, we are trying to push people to think that, okay, our products can last for 25 years. So we're giving 25 years warranty. And for example, you have to pay for, let's say, 4 to 5 years. So in the next 4 to 5 years, when you have to pay financing and you break even in the next 4 to 5 years, afterwards, after 4 to 5 years, you have the next, say, 20 to 21 years where you're having an excess of energy, where you don't have to pay maybe around 70% of the energy if you have the solar pad. And if you're talking about, you have the battery solutions where you're having your power stored into the battery and being used at the nighttime, you're talking about 80 to 90% of the battery not being used. And, you know, you don't have to pay to the government anymore for this.
Mm-hmm. Okay, very interesting. Thank you so much for your explanation, Papa Michael. Before we continue, I would like to remind our audience for today, kepada Bapak Ibu seluruh peserta acara Mandiri webinar hari ini, kami ingin menginformasikan bahwa nanti di akhir acara akan ada undian door prize. Oleh karena itu, untuk Bapak Ibu yang ingin mengikuti door prize, kami mohon untuk scan QR code yang sudah tampil di layar Anda. Bisa langsung scan di sini QR code-nya untuk registrasi ya, pendaftaran untuk bisa mengikuti undian door prize. Jadi tinggal scan QR code atau nanti kita juga akan kirimkan link QR code ke kolom chat untuk bisa Anda akses. Ini adalah syarat untuk bisa mengikuti undian door prize di akhir acara nanti. Mohon untuk registrasi terlebih dahulu melalui QR code yang tersedia di layar Anda ataupun melalui link yang tertera di kolom chat. Oke, baik. Bapak, Ibu sekalian, baik, kita akan lanjutkan Mandiri Private Webinar kali ini. Sekarang saya akan kembali ke Pak Andri. Pak Andri, pastinya kan pemerintah kita saat ini tidak bisa berinvestasi ke seluruh proyek yang mendukung climate actions ataupun sustainability goals. Tapi pemerintah bagaimanapun telah menunjukkan komitmennya ya Pak. Menurut Bapak saat ini pada masa pemerintahan Presiden Jokowi, apakah komitmen nyata itu sudah terlihat melalui kebijakan-kebijakan yang dikeluarkan oleh pemerintahan Presiden Jokowi? Dan apakah kebijakan anggarannya juga terlihat, Pak? Baik, sebentar. Pak Andri, mohon maaf suaranya tidak terdengar.
Sorry, forget to unmute.
Sekarang sudah, Pak.
Yes. All right. So before we talk about the incentive for the green economy, of course, we have to know the 6 focus of the government in 2022 and the going forward. I think in the di jangka pendek, ya, saya mix aja ya, bahasa Inggris, bahasa Indonesia. Di jangka pendek, katakan di tahun 2022, tentu saja fokus pemerintah adalah bagaimana kemudian bisa recover ya dari dampak COVID-19. Ya, tentu saja juga di tahun 2022 nanti memang masih besar ketidakpastian karena varian baru misalnya. Tentu saja pemerintah harus ya mencadangkan anggaran ya untuk perlinsos ini gitu. Jadi ini juga sudah well targeted juga menurut kami. Nah, namun di saat yang bersamaan pemerintah sangat committed nih Mbak Zilvia. Jadi kalau kita lihat di sini, there are several incentives ya. For example, for the for the automotive sector misalnya, untuk kalau kita bicara tentang insentif untuk otomotif, bukan hanya sekarang based on besarnya atau sisi, tapi juga bagaimana kemudian kendaraan tersebut menghasilkan karbon, ya, menghasilkan polusi karbon tadi atau tidak gitu. Semakin clean tentu saja semakin kecil gitu tax-nya gitu. Jadi ini yang kemudian arah yang kalau kita lihat nih memang arah dan keseriusan dari pemerintah untuk mendorong green economy tadi.
Pak Andri, apakah Anda juga melihat sekarang aliran modal ke dalam untuk bisa mewujudkan proyek-proyek berkelanjutan di Indonesia ini sudah semakin banyak, Pak? Sudah on the track?
Ya, memang kalau dilihat dari yang aliran modal, ya inward investment itu towards more on the electric vehicle related ya. Memanfaatkan sumber daya mineral kita ya di Sulawesi misalnya. Nah, ke depan memang akan banyak juga kemudian investment yang related to auto related masih. Jadi yang di luar itu ya, itu memang masih relatif kecil dan kami meyakini memang ke depan ini ruangnya masih akan sangat besar nih untuk investasi masuk ke renewable energies dan juga green economy related.
Oke, gitu. Baik. Baik, Pak Andri. Selanjutnya kita akan menghubungkan ke bagaimana isu mengenai coal ya di COP26. Saya ingin beralih lagi ke Dr. Thomas. So much fanfare was made on the commitments to phase out coal at COP26. An industry which is largely driven with a private enterprise for profit mindset. What are going to be the drivers to make this phase out be realized?
I think it's going to be simple economics, to be honest. As I mentioned earlier, yes, government pledges have a role to play, but ultimately we think it's the improved cost competitiveness of renewables that is simply going to drive this transition much quicker. Even in the US, for instance, when we still had the Trump administration in power, which was quite pro-coal, we saw coal plants go bankrupt. Today, in already large parts of the world, wind energy is already more cost competitive than coal. In China, wind energy is expected to become cost competitive with coal by the middle of this decade. So simply the economics of coal start to make less and less sense. If you add to that, that in many export markets, which are now moving towards net zero, there's a growing concern not only on the emissions within these economies, but the emissions linked to the products that they import. If countries exporting economies, including China, including Indonesia, seek to export products into some of these regions, it will be important that those products will have been produced in a greener manner to maintain access to those markets or to actually gain access to green premium for more cleanly produced products. So it's simply these economic incentives that we think will drive the phase out of coal, potentially at an even faster rate than government policy might do.
Okay. You mentioned Indonesia before. So you know that in Indonesia, coal is a very important sector and is a big export contributor. Is there an expectation on what will replace this element of GDP here or elsewhere?
Well, the same is true, I think, for all fossil fuels. There needs to be a recognition that the market for some of these exports is going to gradually disappear over the next decades. So the challenge here is to start recognizing that those cash flows that get generated, that we shouldn't reinvest them in more fossil fuels, in more coal, but simply that it's about starting to redirect those flows into alternative sectors of the economy. And yes, renewables can be a part of that, but it's not the only one. There's also going to be a large and growing demand for various other green technologies, ranging from the equipment you need to actually drive renewable power, to electric vehicles, to greener steel plants and otherwise. There's a huge opportunity there for manufacturing economies to shift and reorient themselves into those kind of climate relevant products that face significant growth potential. So it's about redirecting those cash flows into the right investments.
Okay, so if a country cannot find replacement of this coal, what do you think will be the impact of the country?
What exactly do you mean with cannot find a replacement for the coal?
Yes. If a country cannot find a replacement for this coal, so what do you think will be the impact for the country?
I'm not sure I entirely understand the question. See, the good thing about renewables is that they are generally available to most countries as an alternative power source. When it comes to redirecting to alternative opportunities to invest some of that funding in, that too already exists. Indeed, if we look at where many Southeast Asian economies are today, they are already significant manufacturing economies that are well prepared to indeed accept some of these greater cash flows. So it is about identifying the competitive strengths that economies already have, the technologies, the technological know-how they have, and how it might be repurposed into similar technologies that may indeed be more closely linked to the climate transition. Mm-hmm. So it's about looking very carefully and introspectively at what sectors of the economy may be repurposed towards this end.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Thomas, for your explanation. I would like to ask Pak Andri for your opinion on this discussion. Pak Andri, ada tanggapannya, Pak?
Yeah, I think we have to also be careful in the transition, Mbak Zilvia. Yeah. Jadi kalau kita lihat Mbak Zilvia, kalau kita lihat dari pengalaman experience from the European Union and also in China, for example, the transition sometimes is not so smooth, especially when the demand for the clean energy is really high. Yeah, for example, during the recovery from the COVID-19, for example. So we have to take a seriously on mitigating this. So the first thing that we have to do is calculating the supply of the clean energy in Indonesia and smooth transition, because replacing coal for Indonesia is very challenging, because coal contributing, let's say, I'm from the banking sectors. So when we talk about the lending to coal sector, for example, around 3-5%, for example, to the CPO, more than 10% in averaging big banks, for example. So if we do it and calculating, for example, the supply of the clean energy, gas, hydropower, and wind, of course, the replacement of coal will be coming to that kind of renewable energy. I think the key here, for Indonesia is the renewable energy cost and output prices should be relatively competitive, and I'm going to say it's cheaper should be, compared to other fossil fuel based energy, because if it is already, for example, cheaper, of course people doesn't have to be given by incentive, for example, will shift to the clean energy rather than you using the fossil fuel. Look at on the, for example, electric vehicles. When they got incentive, people just move it gradually towards an electric vehicle rather than using the bensin, mobil berbakar bensin, for example. So that's my take on this.
Okay, Andri, so it's very challenging. Yeah, doable, yes. But we need a smooth transition,
Terima exactly. Kasih. The key is on the smooth transition.
Smooth transition, that's right. Okay, you mentioned before about the electronic vehicles, so I'm going to ask Pak Michael about that. One of Indonesia's key priorities is the development of EVs right now, so I believe Moderna also have some projects about related to this. So could you please share about the plans that you have and progress in this area?
Sure. So I think the EV development is something that's going on at the moment. This is very exciting for us, although there's a lot of parts of this that's still confidential in nature. I'll still tell you a little bit about the progress that we have at the moment. So the first, we're not only thinking about the EV, we have to think about the whole ecosystem of products. So what I'm talking about the ecosystem is also working on the infrastructure behind it. Meaning that if we want to push, and governments want to push consumers to move from gasoline-based engines, from internal combustion engines to EV, we have to also build the EV charging stations as well. So this is one of the first products that Moderna has done, we're able to have our charging stations for the home and also for commercial purposes. And we're also very proud because we have the capability to charge a car from 0 to 100% in only 45 minutes. So this is one of the first things that we have to talk about, is the infrastructure behind the car.
Yeah.
The second point that I wanted to bring up is about EV conversion kits. Because in going into the EV sector, we're not going to go directly to building the car itself. Because one of the things that I think about is that when we're thinking about emerging countries like Indonesia, Vietnam, Thailand, Singapore, well, Singapore's not an emerging country, but we're talking about the whole region of Southeast Asia, car taxes are really, really expensive. So we're expecting for people to purchase and to switch their already working car to an electric car, there's a big investment that's being involved here. So one of the things that we're doing now is EV conversion kits, meaning that we can take, let's say, your car, take out the engine, we can put our battery technology, and we're able to push this all as a package so that you don't need to buy a car. You can use your already existing car and just switch it to EV. And we're trying to package this at only $3,000. So this will allow a lot of mass to gain momentum for EV adoption.
Okay. And Pak Michael, what about other new projects that which will have also a strong sustainability focus? Can you share any plans do you have in mind about this?
Sure. So outside of EV and outside of the mobility sector, we're also working on a lot of infrastructural projects as well. So one of the things we're working on an undisclosed smart city project in Abu Dhabi and in Oman together with the Al-Futtaim Group. Also developing battery storage solutions as well in Australia. This is being mindful that in Australia there's a lot of instability in the outback. So we're going to be putting a lot of these battery solutions in the outbacks in Australia. And one more project that we're working on at the moment is also on solar farms that we're putting in the Balkan region together with Serbia's roaming group. So I think it's really important when you're talking about energy, we can't just think about the electric vehicle side of things. Just because people are going to be adopting electric cars doesn't mean that the world is going to go zero carbon footprint. You also have to think about the city level and the home level as well. So I think this is really important to think about the whole ecosystem.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Pak Michael. And next to Dr. Thomas. So I'm going to move about nature protection. As we know, is a key aspect in climate change and one recognized in COP13 held in Bali, where the first commitment to forestry protection were made. Could you share some of the data on the impact of the biodiversity, which has been driven by climate change, and the potential which investment in this area can actually have?
Yeah, it's a great question. Of course, today much of the focus is on climate change, but what we really have to recognize is that climate change is one of many environmental challenges that we face today. We've adopted a framework called the Planetary Boundaries, which was developed by a set of Swedish researchers who identified that there's actually 9 planetary systems that today are under threat. Climate change is one of these, but other challenges we face relate to excess use of water, deforestation, biodiversity loss, and agrochemical pollution, the slow degradation of our soils. All of these are challenges where we see significant environmental, but also, once again, economic implications. If we look across the economy as a whole, around half of our economy directly or indirectly depends on nature. And today it's in a very rapid state of decline. In some parts of the world, we've lost 50 to 70% of our biodiversity already. And it's starting to affect the ability of nature to actually support our economy. When we indeed commit to excess deforestation, for instance, we may be generating temporary economic flows generated from those flows of timber, but at the same time, we're destroying the productive assets that lies underneath it. It's a little bit as if you're only looking at a company, looking at its cash flows rather than at its balance sheet. And that is very much how many countries, governments today are still approaching this issue. They're not taking account of what we call their natural capital and how that natural capital today is being destroyed by some of our economic practices. So okay. The way we see it, we need to move from an economy not only that is cleaner, but also one that is much more regenerative in nature, that appreciates the value of natural capital and its direct relationship to our economy.
Okay, and what about the funding of investments into other SDGs such as water, health, and gender equality? Is this coming more from the investment community or social programs from NGOs and government project assistance through development partnerships?
I think it has to be a combination of both, clearly. This is a typical area where there's a need for what we call blended finance. Finance coming in part from public sources, from developmental sources, but the private sector has to be involved as well. Some of this depends on the maturity of different technologies. In a very early stage, before there's a prospect of real commercialization, that is perhaps where you need more public funding. But as soon as you start to move into early stage commercialization or growth opportunities, that is when you start seeing venture capital and growth equity getting involved in some of these opportunities. Certainly, that is where some of the larger scale of capital can be found. And certainly, these are themes that to many investors and to many of our clients are certainly of interest. Water, in particular, is one where there's a tremendous scope for innovation, for improvement in water efficiency, in water management solutions, in the redesign of urban systems. And all of those present sizable investment opportunities that are very much top of our agenda.
Okay. So my next questions are the two latest questions, the last questions that I'm going to ask before we end this session. So this question applies to all of the speakers. Could you share some of the key internal actions which your companies or your institutions are taking to raise awareness and invest into SDGs? Maybe I'll start with Dr. Thomas first, and then Pak Michael, and the last is Pak Andri. Please, Dr. Thomas.
Yes, thank you. So I think our main effort over the last year or two, and my team has been a part of that, is to develop better insights that actually help us understand where to deploy that capital. Our challenge has been, if we look at traditional ESG data, it is tended to be very backwards looking. It tells you the footprint of a company today or its exposure to past controversies. It doesn't tell you all that much about how a company or its business model is evolving, whether it is indeed decarbonizing quickly enough, whether it is addressing its water issues in an effective manner. What we need to be able to assess this more effectively are what we call forward-looking metrics that look precisely at that, at the rate of decarbonization, and compare that against what needs to be achieved in a given sector. We've developed something called an implied temperature rise metric. It looks not at a carbon footprint of a company, it looks at whether it is decarbonizing in line with what needs to be achieved for the Paris Agreement, to translate that into a global warming figure, the level of global warming that would result if every company in the economy were to be managing its emissions in a similar fashion. It's those kind of new, more sophisticated insights that we will need to navigate this transition.
Okay. Thank you so much. And then, Bapa Michael, the same questions. Could you share some of the key that your company or institution take to raise awareness and invest into SDGs?
Sure. So we're not only thinking about products which we're developing that is in going for a greener future, but we're also thinking about the production process as well. So we're thinking about every step of the value chain. So one of the things that Modena has been doing, which I think that's very unique to the industry, is that we're trying to use recycled materials with the productions. So for example, when you're looking at a machine, these are using recycled steel as well, so that we're able to recycle to make a product that is as close as to zero carbon footprint as possible as well. And one more thing that we have been doing is also, even as far as the boxes are concerned, the boxes are made of 99% recycled materials, things like we've even started to do digital digital warranty card. So nowadays, sometimes there are lots of countries where they have to have a warranty card. This is not possible, but a lot of the countries that we're into, they are starting to accept digital QR code as a form of warranty card. So you can find a lot of the warranty card on our website nowadays. So I know it sounds like a small step of trying to go green, but when you're thinking about large mass, we're selling millions and millions of units, this makes a large difference as to how much paper you can save.
Okay, thank you so much, Pak Michael, for sharing with us. And the last but not least, Pak Andri, could you also share your thoughts about this?
Yeah, of course, when we talk about the SDGs, yeah, in the banking sector, we know it also we have to comply on ESG, environmental sustainability, and also the governance. So when we talk about this, so the first one, the first thing that we have to prioritize is using more efficient energy in every business. And number two is how to build more knowledge on the renewable on the ESGs, yeah, related. So we build team, for example, in Bank Mandiri, we have some people already analyzes and also building a team to giving lending towards more ESG related sectors, for example. So going forward, Bank Mandiri, for example, we already started by giving towards some more renewable energies and limited to giving the lending, for example, to coal related. And also, not to forget, we also giving the lending to people empowerment, yeah, to the small medium enterprises empowerment as well. Because when we talk about the sustainability, we're not talking about the when we talk about the ESG, we're not only thinking about the environmental as well, but we have to think about the sustainability as well. So in Bank Mandiri, the policies is clear, yeah. We will support the people's empowerment, the small medium enterprises, and also the environmental sustainability. Mm-hmm. And the last one, I think we try to finding more sources, yeah, of financing based on the ESG scheme. I think that's all the, the actions.
Thank you so much. Terima kasih, Bapak Andri. Dan terakhir sebelum kita masuk ke sesi Q&A, Pak Andri mungkin juga bisa sharing, Pak, soal update dari financial market dan sektor-sektor apa nih yang menurut Bapak sangat potensial untuk bisa berkembang tahun depan?
Ya, of course, when we talk about the financial market right now, especially for the banking sector, in September, we know that banking lending, yeah, banks lending already reached 3%. Basil, yeah. So 3% year-to-date lending growth, yeah. I think it is more positive and beyond everyone's target this year, yeah. Previously, we only think, for example, 3% lending growth only happened in the full year figure. But right now, year-to-date, we already reached per September 3%. We expect that the lending growth this year will touch around 4 to 6%. So this is actually in line with the improvement of the GDP. Yeah. Now, when we talk about the 2022, of course, we expect that lending growth will touch more than 6%. Our baseline figure, for example, the lending growth going in 2022 will touch around 6 to 8%. Yeah. Our base figure, for example, 6.6% lending growth. Mm-hmm. So the second one, I think, the improvement in the sectors in Indonesia has already been enlarged. Yeah, when we talk about 2020, only certain sectors that already recover from the pandemic or having a benefited or positive impact from the COVID-19. For example, telco related. But right now, when we talk about the recovery, it's already wide, relatively across the board. So, for example, for the retail trade, communication. Some of the manufacturing industries, yeah, some of the wholesale trade actually already recovered, yeah, and also the transportation when the government already started to recover or to relax the mobility, of course it impacts also to the transportation related sectors. The other one, when we talk about the property sectors, yeah. and also to the cement sector. So many sectors actually already been improving compared to what we had in 2020. So when we talk about going forward in 2022, of course, yeah, more sectors will be, you know, benefiting from the recovery. The key is only one: how we maintain the lower case or the low case of COVID-19. So with this assumption, of course, more sectors will be, you know, recovered.
Baik, oke, betul ya Pak Andri. Jadi kesuksesan kita dalam menangani pandemi COVID-19 ini akan sangat berkontribusi pada pertumbuhan ekonomi kita pada tahun 2022. Thank you for your answers. And now we are going to move to Q&A session. We have already received some questions from our audience. And I'm going to ask to our speakers. The first from Henny Saragi. Pada tahun 2022, produk apa yang baik untuk berinvestasi? Oke, mungkin ini kita tunjukkan dulu kepada Pak Andri ya. Pak Andri, jadi diminta sarannya nih Pak, untuk tahun 2022, produk apa untuk berinvestasi? And maybe I'm going to ask the opinion from the other speakers as well. Please Pak Andri, you go first.
Ya, oke. Okay. Ini produk investasi ya. yang pertama tadi saya sudah sampaikan baseline-nya. Ya, ekspektasi kita tentu saja, ini karena pertanyaannya dalam bahasa Indonesia, saya coba bahasa Indonesia. Jadi yang pertama adalah baseline figure-nya adalah bahwa kita berharap ekonomi akan relatif lebih ekspansif ya tahun 2020. Tentu saja ya kita berharap sekali nih bahwa new variant Omicron itu tidak melebar dan kemudian menyebabkan seperti yang kita hadapi di bulan Juli yang lalu. Ya pertama, mengapa bisa begitu yakin? Kita bisa lihat di tahun 2021 kemarin, ya Mbak Silvia, ya, itu kita losing to growth momentum, yaitu di bulan Januari Februari ketika kita melengah ya menjaga protokol kesehatan, kemudian kasus COVID naik dan kemudian pemerintah memperketat lagi mobilitas. Akhirnya di situ ekonomi drop lagi. Yang kedua adalah di bulan Juli yang lalu, pasca Lebaran kita lengah dalam memperketat protokol kesehatan di antara kita, kemudian naik kasusnya dan ekonomi kemudian terjerembab lagi. Nah, harapannya if we can lose those two risk, ya. Yeah. For example, in 2022 we expect of course economic growth will, like I mentioned before, economic growth will recover fast. For example, in 2022. So, now back to your question, produk apa? Yang pertama, kita masih melihat bahwa saham sebenarnya masih relatif menarik untuk trading, okay, ya. Bahkan kalau ke depan kalau ekonomi tumbuh ya otomatis ekspektasi dari return dari JCI tentu akan relatif ekspansi dibandingkan dengan yang sama. Terus kemudian akan ada resiko kenaikan suku bunga acuan ke depannya. Ya, tapi kalau kita lihat ada sektor-sektor yang justru kemudian terkena dampak positif karena memang ada recovery dari pemulihan dibandingkan juga dengan kekhawatiran karena kenaikan suku bunga acuan. Dan kami meyakini bahwa kalaupun ada kenaikan, memang suku bunga di bank pun juga tidak, contohnya untuk lending, itu tidak akan dinaikkan secara signifikan karena akan berdampak negatif kepada sektor usaha. Yang berikutnya reksadana tentu saja masih akan kalau dari sisi misalnya resiko Bapak Ibu misalnya resikonya masih risk avoider misalnya, ya ambil yang reksadana yang relatif lebih aman, kemudian ditaruh dan kemudian kalau udah mulai misalnya udah berani untuk ekspansi ya bisa mengambil untuk trading di saham. Dan sekarang yang terakhir, bagaimana dengan obligasi, ekspektasi kenaikan suku bunga atau bond yield-nya? Saya rasa kalau tetap trading dan adanya inflows ya yang masih berlanjut, saya rasa tetap ada peluang untuk di bonds market. Ya, kuncinya kalau di bonds ya tentu saja adanya ekspektasi tetap capital outflows-nya tidak besar di tahun 2022. Jadi all in all, saya rasa kalau dari sisi instrumen itu yang tadi saya sampaikan, kalau untuk sektor, nah ini properti menurut saya ya 2022 ini juga relatif lebih baik.
Baik, oke, terima kasih Pak Andri. Karena keterbatasan waktu, kita lanjut dulu ya ke pertanyaan kedua dan masih ada pertanyaan ketiga. So we are going to move to the second and the third questions. So the second questions, pertanyaan yang kedua. Oke, so from Elisa Yuliati, selamat sore. Mau bertanya juga kepada Pak Andri, investasi apa yang paling bagus prospeknya untuk tahun 2022? Dan bagaimana nasib sektor properti di tahun 2022? Sebetulnya sudah terjawab ya oleh Pak Andri barusan sekali ya Pak. Mungkin saya ingin minta tanggapannya juga kali ya. Saya ingin minta tanggapan ke Dr. Thomas. This is not exactly related to the questions, but our audience is asking about what is the product investment for the next year. Dr. Thomas, do you have any opinion about this? Do you think that a sustainable investment is also good? Is also having a good prospect for the next year?
Yes, we believe so. In fact, one of the things that has come out of COVID, the recovery of the pandemic, is a focus on what we call build back better. Mm-hmm. If we see some of the recovery packages that have been announced by governments around the world, there's been a clear recognition that if we're going to significantly ramp up government spending in these sectors, then perhaps that spending should already be aligned with longer term priorities as well. We've certainly seen that in Europe, in the US and other parts as well. So that's driving an inflow of capital, an inflow, an increase in interest in some of these very same activities. So that's driving the near term economics for this forward as well. And of course, even coming out of COP26, there's been so much news coming out of this that markets are very much in the process of adjusting to that. And that momentum won't cease. One of the things that came out of COP26 is that rather than governments realigning or ratcheting up their commitments every 5 years, that's now going to be done every year. So even by the end of 2022, we'll see a next round of negotiations take place. So there's momentum in these green markets. It's going to keep moving forward. And we've seen markets respond to that in real time, even as COP26 was unfolding. So certainly, this is no longer a long-term transition. This is a near-term development.
Okay, thank you for sharing your thoughts. And the last questions, please. The last questions, pertanyaan terakhir. Okay. From Troy, bila pemerintah mulai melakukan peralihan ke energi terbarukan, sejauh mana hal tersebut akan mempengaruhi harga komoditas, terutama batu bara? Dan bagaimana tanggapan atas sikap Indonesia terhadap tuntutan Eropa di WTO dan sejauh mana pengaruhnya terhadap ekonomi dalam negeri pada waktu dekat? Ini pertanyaan yang bagus sekali ya. Apakah ini untuk Pak Andri nih yang cocok untuk menjawabnya? Pak Andri, silakan Pak. Masih di mute sepertinya Pak, audionya.
Ya, okay. Sudah.
Sudah.
Lupa. Oke, baik. Kalau kita yang pertama yang ingin saya sampaikan adalah bagaimana ekspektasi kami terhadap harga komoditas, baik ke batu bara, CPO ya atau palm oil dan juga rubber. Sebenarnya Mbak Zilvia ya, tanpa adanya COVID-19 ya, tanpa adanya WTO, kalau kita lihat tadi saya sampaikan di paparan global growth ke depan itu ekspektasinya akan melambat. Pertumbuhan ekonomi China itu ekspektasinya tahun 2025, ini ekspektasi IMF ya, dan tidak berubah trennya. 2025-2026 itu pertumbuhannya akan terus turun sampai di kisaran 5%. Nah, kalau kita bicara fundamental, sebenarnya demand for commodity itu will subdue. Ya, will drop quite significant compared to what we had in 2011, for example, ketika pertumbuhan ekonomi China mencapai 9,9% atau bahkan di 10%, ya, mendekati 10%. Ya. Nah, dengan kondisi tersebut, sebenarnya ya harga batu bara harusnya memang akan relatif turun ke depan. 2022 ekspektasi kami untuk batu bara, ya coal price, CPO dan juga rubber itu akan gradually normalize ya dibandingkan dengan kondisi sekarang. Kalau kondisi sekarang harganya melejit terus kemudian udah sekarang udah turun lagi, itu memang karena tadi unsmooth transition tadi. Jadi ketika ada shock ya permintaan yang tinggi terus kemudian yang supply dari clean energy-nya nggak bisa mengcover, ya ada peningkatan di harga batu bara tadi. Nah, itu jawaban kami untuk yang pertama. Yang kedua, bagaimana kemudian terkait dengan Eropa? Saya rasa Eropa akan terus seperti itu. Yang kita lakukan adalah bagaimana kemudian fokus ya mengembangkan sektor-sektor hilirisasi tadi. Ya, ini yang kemudian akan berdampak positif buat pertumbuhan ekonomi di Indonesia. Dan kalau kita lihat statement Pak Presiden kan sudah jelas dalam beberapa tahun terakhir ya kita perlu adanya hilirisasi supaya memang tidak tergantung ada dari komoditas sendiri. Ya. Jadi kalau kita lihat dan urutin Mbak Zilvia dan Bapak Ibu semua, sebenarnya guidance dari pemerintah Indonesia itu jelas. Bahkan sebelum COP26 itu udah jelas, kita berupaya untuk mendorong hilirisasi. Nah, hilirisasi itu kan nanti juga kita lihat arahnya bisa kepada yang tadi sektor-sektor komoditas yang bisa mendorong turunan dari komoditas tadi ya, yang bisa mendorong kemudian perekonomian Indonesia. Jadi pertanyaan berikutnya adalah apakah akan berdampak kemudian drastis kepada pertumbuhan ekonomi Indonesia? Saya rasa kalau hilirisasinya berhasil, Mbak Sylvia, itu tentu ya saja akan berdampak positif juga buat pertumbuhan ekonomi Indonesia. Dan satu lagi nih poin pentingnya, Bapak Ibu semua, kita memiliki sumber pertumbuhan yang baru, gitu. Yang pertama, yang kedua, kita mensupport industri manufaktur di Indonesia. Gitu. Ya. Industri manufaktur di Indonesia itu adalah nomor dua yang berkontribusi besar terhadap PDB Indonesia. Nah, ini yang menurut saya nomor satu atau nomor dua tadi.
Oke.
Baik. Begitu jawaban saya.
Ya, terima kasih Pak Andri atas jawabannya. Dengan demikian, Bapak-Ibu sekalian, selesai sudah ya sesi Q&A kita. Izinkan saya mengucapkan terima kasih kepada para pembicara kita pada hari ini. Thank you so much for Dr. Thomas Hon Smartbooth, Head of Sustainability Research at Lombard Odier. And then to Bapak Michael Gizar, Executive Vice President of Moderna Global LTD, and of course to Bapak Andri Asmoro, Chief Economist Bank Mandiri. Thank you so much for investing your time, your energy, your thought. Thank you so much for all the knowledge, and I hope that our audience find it very useful, very insightful, helpful, and also hopeful for them to face any kind of challenges in the future. Thank you so much, Bapak-Bapak. Thank you so much for joining us here. And we, of course, we'd love to have another moment with three of you. Terima kasih. Thank you so much. Baiklah, Bapak-Ibu sekalian, setelah kita berdiskusi dengan para narasumber kita tadi, sekarang saatnya seperti janji saya tadi, kita akan ada undian door prize di akhir acara. Dan bagi Bapak Ibu yang sudah registrasi melalui QR code tadi, kita akan segera mengundinya ya. Sudah ada, nanti kami akan tampilkan di sini wheel of name, sudah ada nama-nama Bapak-Bapak Ibu-Ibu yang sudah melakukan registrasi. Kita akan langsung putarkan ya, 3 pemenang. Oke, kita mulai yang pertama. Oke, dan iya. Oke, okay. Stop. Oke, okay. Sudah ya. Elisa Yuliati. Oke, okay. Selamat untuk Elisa Yuliati. Berikutnya kita akan putar untuk pemenang undian yang kedua. Dan jatuh kepada. Oke. Okay. Ternyata Halim Tirta Putra. Ya, selamat untuk Halim Tirta Putra. Dan masih ada satu lagi kesempatan Bapak Ibu untuk mendapatkan souvenir. Kita putar lagi. Oke, untuk pemenang undian yang ketiga adalah ternyata Sarah Amalia Hasana. Oke, lengkap sudah ya pemenang undian door prize kita untuk acara hari ini Bapak Ibu semua. Baiklah, dengan demikian nanti kami akan menghubungi untuk para pemenang undian door prize, Bapak-Ibu semuanya. Bapak-Ibu sekalian, demikianlah akhir dari acara Mandiri Private Webinar Financing the Sustainable Economy. Hari ini, sekali lagi kami tentu mengucapkan apresiasi dan terima kasih yang sebesar-besarnya kepada 3 pembicara yang telah menyempatkan waktunya bersama kita tadi, membagikan ilmu, pengalaman, dan juga berbagai analisa yang pastinya bisa membantu Bapak Ibu semua untuk mengambil keputusan yang tepat di masa mendatang, terutama untuk menghadapi tahun 2022. Baiklah, semoga bermanfaat dan tentu saja kita berikan apresiasi kepada para penyelenggara acara hari ini. Ada Forbes Indonesia, Lombard Odier, dan juga Mandiri Private. Akhir kata, saya Zilvia Iskandar pamit undur diri, mohon maaf atas segala kekurangan, dan mudah-mudahan kita bisa berjumpa lagi di lain kesempatan. Selamat sore dan salam sehat selalu.
Kita semua memiliki prioritas yang berbeda. Prioritasku dalam berkarya adalah mewujudkan sebuah visi. Aku ingin semua yang telah kucapai tidak berhenti di sini, namun terus berkembang. Tidak ada yang memahami prioritasku selain diriku sendiri dan Bank Mandiri.
Mandiri Prioritas, memahami prioritas Anda untuk kini dan masa depan.
Yuk, kenalan dengan New Livin by Mandiri, super app financial dari Bank Mandiri yang siap jadi sahabat kamu. Install sekarang dan nikmati beragam fitur menarik dengan tampilan futuristik yang tentunya bikin transaksi kamu lebih nyaman. Tunggu apa lagi? Download dan cobain sekarang ya. Jangan salah pilih, New Livin by Mandirinya yang logo kuning. Buka aplikasi New Livin, klik punya kartu debit atau kredit Mandiri, baca dan setujui syarat dan ketentuannya, terus masukin tuh data kartu dan informasi pribadi kamu. Pastiin udah bener semua ya. Untuk melakukan verifikasi, kirim SMS tanpa mengubah isi pesannya. Untuk kamu yang pakai handphone Android, setelah SMS terkirim, jangan lupa tekan tombol back dan kembali lagi ke aplikasi New Livin. Supaya kamu bisa bertransaksi dengan aman dan nyaman, pastikan kombinasi password yang kamu pilih tidak mengandung informasi pribadi, mengandung perulangan, atau berurutan. Selesai deh, kamu sudah bisa bertransaksi pakai New Livin. Sekarang, kamu udah bisa melakukan berbagai transaksi di mana saja, kapan saja. Cobain juga fitur tarik tunai tanpa kartu, transaksi praktis pakai Quick Pick, dan cek sisa saldo rekening atau sisa limit kartu kredit dengan cepat dari layar depan. Semuanya bisa tanpa login. Nggak hanya itu loh, New Livin by Mandiri punya banyak fitur yang sayang untuk kamu lewatkan. Keren banget kan? Yuk, download sekarang juga. Yang ikonnya kuning ya. Nikmati semua kemudahan yang dihadirkan New Livin khusus untuk kamu. Living a lively life with New Livin by Mandiri.